As far as Salvage jobs go, Oasis' debut album, Definitely Maybe, was an extraordinary achievement. Recorded at a cost of 75,000 sterling, using several different studios, the album betrays few of the problems that dogged its 7-month gestation. Recording an album should never have been this difficult, reflected Noel Gallagher. I will take you on a journey from studio to studio, chronicling their journey from the very first song Oasis recorded in Out of the Blue Studio up until the final song recorded by Noel Gallagher in Mark Coyles' living room. If you like this kind of content, be sure to press the subscribe button and check out my other videos. If you have any questions or bits of information to contribute, please comment below. Thanks. The very first studio Oasis used was Out of the Blue Studio in Manchester in October of 1993. This was not the first time Oasis used this studio. Back in 1991, the studio needed their walls plastered, so Tony McCarroll, Bonehead and Gwigsy plastered their walls in their studio in exchange for some recording time. Oasis used this time to record three tracks, Alice, Take Me and Reminisce. The original tape from this recording still exists today. It was auctioned on eBay in 2003 and is now in a private Oasis collection. Fast forward exactly 2 years later to October of 1993 and Oasis are back in Out of the Blue Studio. Not to plaster the walls this time, but in fact to record the very first track that would make it onto Definitely Maybe. And that track was Shaker Maker. Shaker Maker was Oasis' second single to be released, their first single being Supersonic. Shaker Maker was inspired by a song called I'd Like to Teach the World to Sing, which was owned by Coca-Cola. Oasis were later sued by Coca-Cola due to the songs being so similar. If you listen to both tracks side by side, you can clearly hear where Noel got his inspiration from. Michael Spencer Jones, Oasis' official photographer, was present for the Out of the Blue Studio recordings. It was Michael's first ever photo shoot with Oasis. Michael witnessed and heard Noel recording the Shaker Maker demo, and it was this actual demo recording that was later used on the Definitely Maybe album. Michael not only heard Noel demoing Shaker Maker, but he actually photographed Noel doing so. Michael got some black and white photographs of Noel playing slide guitar on his Epiphone Les Paul. The original photographs Michael took were in black and white, and he later colourised these photographs to stunning effect. Noel used his Epiphone Les Paul to record Shaker Maker, which can be seen in the photographs taken by Michael Spencer Jones. This was Noel's main guitar from around 1992 to 1994. Noel can also be seen using this guitar in the 1992 Oasis rehearsal video footage taken by Bobby Langley in the Boardwalk rehearsal room in Manchester. Johnny Marr mentions this guitar in his autobiography, Set the Boy Free. Johnny mentions visiting Noel in his flat in India House, where Noel showed Johnny his two most valuable items in his world, his Epiphone guitar and his fish tank. Back then, Oasis didn't have money to spend on expensive guitars, so pretty much all the guitars they used were Epiphones, until Johnny Marr came onto the scene and offered to loan Oasis a collection of Gibson guitars. The second studio Oasis recorded Definitely Maybe in was the Pink Museum in Liverpool from the 17th to the 20th of December 1993. Oasis had went into the studio to record Bring It On Down, which Creation Records boss Alan McGee wanted to be their first single. They also went in to record some B-sides, I Will Believe and Take Me Away. Hamby Haralambos, the manager of The Real People and also the owner of the Pink Museum, recalled Tony Griffiths from The Real People dropping by while Oasis were in the studio recording. Tony wasn't too impressed with the songs he heard. Noel tried to explain that they were just B-sides, though Tony said there are no B-sides anymore. All the songs are on CD, which only have one side. Fair point, I suppose. Hamby recalled Tony asking Noel what track they had been jamming on earlier. It was then decided that they would work on that song. Noel wrote the lyrics there and then in the control room, using his surroundings as inspiration. Engineer Dave Scott's Rottweiler, Elsie, got a name check, and the gin and tonics Noel used to loosen up with also got put into the mix. Noel said, "The song came out of nowhere. I knew it was a classic single as soon as we'd finished recording." Within 11 hours, Oasis had written and recorded their very first single, Supersonic, which would also make it onto the album. The photograph used on the cover of the Supersonic single was taken by Michael Spencer Jones in Monnow Valley Studio. Noel is sitting on a piano playing an Epiphone EA-250. Noel also used this Epiphone in Oasis's very first official Creation Records photo shoot with photographer James Fry in November of 1993. Noel also can be seen using this guitar in an early TV appearance on the 1st of July 1994 for a show called Something for the Weekend, where Oasis performed three songs. Noel used primarily Epiphones in the early days because they were more affordable at the time than a Gibson or the like. Liam, only 21 at the time, recorded the vocals for Supersonic in just one take. All those years rehearsing in the boardwalk paid off. Bonehead, Gwigsy and Tony McCarroll played an integral part in the creation of Supersonic, as it was the band as a whole whose jamming inspired Supersonic in the first place. Oasis recorded two songs in the Pink Museum studio. Supersonic was the first song, which was released as a single and also made it onto the Definitely Maybe album. The second song they recorded was a B-side called Take Me Away, which was released on the Supersonic single as well. Unfortunately, Hamby, the owner of the Pink Museum, passed away on the 15th of October 2020. May he rest in peace. The third studio Oasis used was Monnow Valley Studio. On the 8th of January 1994, Oasis settled in for a two-week recording session. Most fans will be familiar with the inside of Monnow Valley Studio as it was featured on the cover of Supersonic. This was the first attempt to record all the album tracks in one go. Unfortunately, these sessions did not get off to a good start and only went downhill from there. Noel said, "The problem started almost from the beginning. It wasn't with the band, the problem was the producer, Dave Batchelor. He was trying too hard to be clever. It was sounding too produced." Engineer Mark Coyles said it was a simple case of conflicting ideas between the producer and the band. Oasis had went in with the intention to record the whole of Definitely Maybe, though after 2 weeks in the studio, all they had to show for their hard work was one song, Slide Away. Mark Coyle believed part of the problem was down to the band using lots of unfamiliar gear, including guitars that Johnny Marr had lent them. One of these guitars was a Gibson Flying V, and it was this guitar that Noel used to record Slide Away. Engineer Dave Scott recalled the guitars Noel used in the studio. Noel was using his Epiphone Les Paul and a few of Johnny Marr's guitars, including a Flying V, which he used on Slide Away. Marcus Russell believed Dave Batchelor had neutered the band, and Noel is quoted as saying, "I know that a song never comes out on tape the way it sounds in your head, but these mixes were so wide of the mark it was a joke. The demos were better." On that note, it was decided that Mark Coyle was the right man for the job, so the baton was passed to him and the lads were off to Cornwall to try again, though the pressure was mounting. Noel said, "I was busy telling everyone it was the best record ever made, but it was sounding like crap." The fourth studio Oasis used was Sawmills in Cornwall. The pressure was now on, though Mark Coyle, Oasis's live sound engineer, knew what needed to be done. He's quoted as saying, "Because I was a live engineer, I knew we had to capture the band rather than produce them." Oasis's drummer Tony McCarroll summed up the difference between the Monnow Valley and the Sawmills experience. "We recorded again as a band in the same room, unlike in Monnow Valley. It was a recreation of the setup we'd had in the rehearsal room at the boardwalk. And we had that feeling back, that understanding that a nod or a wink could bring, that spark. So things literally were back on track again. Oasis were back in their comfort zone, recording as a band. They managed to record pretty much all the tracks except for Sad Song and Married with Children. Mark Coyle, with the help of engineer Anjali Dutt, then took the tapes to Eden Studio to mix. Though despite the quality of the performances Mark captured at the Sawmills, the Eden mixes still proved unsatisfactory. Enter producer Owen Morris. Marcus Russell, Oasis's manager, knew of Owen from his work with Johnny Marr, and he believed if anybody could sort the mixing out, it was Owen. And Owen did exactly that. Oasis were on tour at the time and had for the first time left the responsibility of mixing their songs in the hands of someone else, and all they could do was trust them. While on tour, they would receive tapes of songs Owen had mixed, the first one being Slide Away. When Noel and the band heard it for the first time, they finally heard what it was that they were looking for, and it looked like their trust in Owen had paid off. Owen was only 26 years old at the time and is credited as the man who turned things around. His mixes of the Sawmill sessions make up the majority of the album. The following songs were recorded at Sawmills: Rock and Roll Star, Live Forever, Up in the Sky, Columbia, Bring It On Down, Cigarettes and Alcohol, Dixie's Dinner, and Cloudburst. The fifth studio Oasis used was the Windings in Wrexham. Just in the final stretch now, and it was decided that they needed an additional track for the vinyl version of the album. So instead of all the songs being on one vinyl record, the album would be issued as a double vinyl album to accommodate the sound quality the band were looking for. Plus, this meant a bonus song for the fans who bought the vinyl record. The bonus song would not be included on the CD release. That bonus song was Sad Song. Noel said he demoed the song live on BBC One Sessions and then went into the studio the next day and banged it out inside of 2 hours on his Epiphone acoustic dreadnought 6-string and 12-string guitars. The songs recorded at the Winding Studio were Sad Song and also Up in the Sky. The final song on the album, Married with Children, was actually recorded in producer Mark Coyle's bedroom around 1992 or 1993. It's believed Noel wrote the song on John Squire's Gretsch Country Gentleman guitar and recorded the track using one of his Epiphone acoustics. The song was inspired by the TV sitcom Married with Children. Oasis released their debut album, Definitely Maybe, on the 29th of August 1994. It went straight in at number one in the UK album charts and became the fastest selling album in the UK, and went on to sell 8 million albums worldwide, and the rest is history.